Well, good morning. Turn with me in your Bibles to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. Through the end of spring, we've been walking through a sermon series where we were looking at the work of the Holy Spirit. And then last week, we began a walk through the fruit of the Spirit as laid out in Galatians 5. Did you know that depression worldwide is statistically at 3.8%, but in the United States, 8.5%, more than double? And that was before 2020, because after the worldwide pandemic with COVID, the economy, depression now sits in the United States at 27.8%. Culturally, we lack the ability to handle difficult situations without anxiety and depression, as is currently on display with the skyrocketing of almost daily mass shootings that happen nationwide. What an opportunity for Christians to call out to our culture, come, find healing. Come to the one who offers love, joy, peace, because I know Jesus and he gives me joy. He gives me a joy that's not temporary, it's not fleeting, it is fixed, it is rooted in eternity. He gives me joy. Last week, we began our summer sermon series looking at the fruit of the Spirit. Here's the deal. Because we are Christians and have the permanent indwelling Holy Spirit, the characteristics of who God is over time become our characteristics. And the evidence of his life in us. So Daniel did an incredible job of introducing our series last week, talking about the first fruit, love. And so this morning we come to the second one, and that is joy. So listen, as I read Galatians 5, I'll begin in verse 16, building up to the fruit of the Spirit, which begin in 22. But I say to you, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these things are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality. Now skip down to verse 22. You see that the deeds of the flesh are in opposition to the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and to your word. Father, fill us with your joy. Father, we confess that we are feeble, that our bodies are dust, and that our source of joy and happiness is so flippant. But we long to be rooted and grounded in you, the eternal source of life and joy. Help us this morning to meditate on this incredible truth, that to be in your presence is the fullness of joy. We pray all of that in Jesus' name, amen. Now here's the deal. To quote Charles Spurgeon, the thought of delight in religion is so strange to men that no two words in language seem further apart to us than holiness and delight. No, no, nothing seems further from the truth, holiness and delight. But what we will find this morning is that is not the truth. Guys, this morning we are talking about joy, delight, happiness, laughter, having a smile on your face, that God wants you to be filled with joy, that he is most glorified in you when you are satisfied and overflowing with joy in him. A few years back, I did a study through scripture, and I just looked up every passage that had joy or rejoice or delight in it. Guys, it absolutely just completely altered my view of scripture and of what God longs for us. All right, I could not wait all week for this sermon. It's like I'm taking off the top of your heart, and I just want to pour in this truth to let it simmer and just soak in to your being. As Daniel reminded us last week, God defines and Jesus displays love for us. And so we will begin with a similar foundation for joy. And we're gonna meditate. I have three categories of scripture that I want us to quickly meditate and see that it's there before we jump off, okay? And the first one is that God is joy. What is it like to be in God's presence? Right, when God shows up, what is it like when he is around? What sort of flavor overflows? You ever been in a room where someone prominent walked in the room and everything suddenly changed because it gravitated towards that person? What is it like when God shows up? Zechariah 2:10, sing for joy and be glad. O daughter of Zion, for behold, I am coming and I will dwell in your midst, declares the Lord. When God shows up, sing for joy and be glad. Psalm 16:11, you make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. You pause and you meditate on that for just a moment. In your presence is fullness of joy. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Yes, yes. Both of those truths are woven all through scripture, that to be in the presence of God is to be so in awe, is to be frozen because he is magnificent, but it is also simultaneously to be filled with joy and delight that in his presence is fullness of joy. Have you ever noticed this repeated theme throughout scripture? Throughout the whole of the Bible, that to enter into God's presence is to burst into song, to burst into worship, especially in the Psalms and in the book of Revelation. It's like it's a Disney movie. I mean, you just suddenly burst into song. No one does that when I walk in the room, but when God walks, they burst into song because they're so filled with joy, they can't help it. It's these constant scenes around the throne of God, worshiping and singing because they can't help themselves. Now you say, wait a second. The seraphim shout day and night, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Now, so often when we think of holiness, we think of morally perfect. And it is that. We think of singing, holy, 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 like with perfect posture. But holiness, guys, the actual definition of holiness is separate, other. There is no one like you. That's what the seraphim are shouting. They do not cease to shout day and night, willingly, full of joy. There is no one like you, God. Nothing compares to you. That's the picture. It's not sitting there, holy, holy. No, it is, there is no one like you, God. No one could ever fill our souls with delight and passion, with joy more than you. There's no one like you, God. And that's the scene repeatedly throughout Scripture. Everyone around the throne bursting into song, casting their crowns at his feet. Now, because this is the almost singular view of heaven given in the Bible, this worshiping God, we often take it to mean that heaven will be one unending church service. And you're like, no, thank you. That pastor's long-winded enough. I'm hungry. I'm ready to get out. No, thank you. But guys, that misses the point. Let me explain it to you like this. Every single one of us deeply desire to be happy. In fact, it's an unavoidable truth of man. All men seek happiness. This is without exception, to quote Pascal. What if I were to tell you there is one thing that God could give to you that would fill your soul with the most joy, the most delight, and make you eternally happy? And that if God were to give you this one thing, he would be the greatest, most loving father because he has supplied this one thing to you. Friend, he has already given you that one thing because that one thing is himself. It's why the climax of the entire Bible is Revelation 22, verse 4. And you will see his face. Hallelujah. And you will see his face. And it will be more than you could ever comprehend. It has not entered into the heart of man. All that God has in store for him, when you will stand there and when you will finally be able to behold him and drink it in, he will fill you with so much joy and so much delight. It will take all of eternity to unfold the goodness and the grace of God, and you will continue to drink in more and more and more for all of eternity. I mean, the Bible literally says you cannot comprehend what awaits for you in heaven. You can't even comprehend it. Because to be in God's presence is fullness of joy. That is the picture of the end, that you get him. You get him. Secondly, the second category of scriptures, not only that God is filled, full of joy, but listen to this, God delights to save you, to put you in Christ. He could not wait to save you. And then like a good, loving father, he loves to give good gifts to his children. These scripture passages that I'm about to show are the unfolding that God could not wait to give you his salvation. I remember as a young father, when Eli was born, Lane went home and we had two young kids and I had to take on a second job And it was exhausting. I was tired. I'm working 80 hours a week, and I would remember pulling up in my driveway, and I have so much running through my mind all the time, just kind of this weight, this pressure on me. But I remember sitting in my driveway, my mind's racing, but I knew everything was about to change. Because the second I pushed the garage door button, from across the house, this 18-month-old who could waddle would run across the house and run out through the garage into the driveway and would meet me at the base of my car. And everything changed, right? All the worry and the busyness of this finite father, it washed away because I saw my son with the light. I want you to think about that as I read these verses. The delight that the Father has in his children. Jeremiah 32, I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Okay, he could not wait to give you this covenant, that I will not turn away from them to do them good. And I will put the fear of me in their hearts so that they will not turn away with me. I will rejoice over them. This is God's, God is going to rejoice. I will rejoice over them to do them good and will faithfully plant them in the land with all my heart and with all my soul. That's God speaking about delighting in, he could not wait to give you the new covenant salvation, to send his son and to do good to you. Zephaniah 3. Shout for joy, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O Israel. Rejoice and exalt with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away his judgment against you. He has cleared away your enemies. The Lord your God is in your midst, a victorious warrior. He will exalt over you with joy. And he will be quiet in his love. And he will rejoice over you with shouts of joy. Think about this. Not only does God have endless joy in himself, God delighted to send his son to save you. And as a father, give good gifts to you. Guys, let these passages and 100 others like them pour into your soul. When Jesus wanted to express this in the New Testament, in Luke 15, he does so in a parable that you and I know as the prodigal son. When he looked at what is the father like? He sits on the porch and he looks and he longs for his child to return. And the second he sees him, he sits there with his arms crossed, with a crotchety attitude, and he says, that boy's gonna come back and he's gonna wallow in what he's done. Is that how it goes? No. He looks and he sees and he longs and he's so filled with joy and delight. He cannot contain himself, and he does what no Jewish man would ever do, because it was undignified for a Jewish man to run in public. He would never be caught. It's undignified. Not God. Not God. He says, I don't care. I'm so filled with joy. I'm so filled with delight. He runs to his son. His son starts into his routine. He throws his arms around him. He's filthy. He doesn't care. He throws his arms around him. He kisses him. And he throws the biggest party that there ever was. God's delight in saving and doing good to his children. One more verse through this section. Hebrews 12:2. Jesus, it's talking about Jesus. For the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross and despised the shame. That is, there is the cross, all of its shame, all of its weight. But Jesus looked on the other side and saw joy and said, I'll go through that. I'll go through that to get to the joy on the other side. Guys, if I, as a sinful earthly father, look at my own children I mean, recently, Eli had a talent show and he sang on his ukulele. And I have the video on my phone and I watch it and I rewatch it. If I look at my own children with this much delight, how much more so your heavenly Father in, who is in heaven? I mean, his own words, he has declared to you, I know you don't fully believe it, but he has declared to you his delight in his children. Now the third movement, third section of scriptures is his joy in us. His joy in us, John 15, 11. These things I have spoken to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. That your joy may be full. John 10, 10. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. Nehemiah 8:10, for the joy of the Lord is my strength. You see, God is joy. God delights to save and to do good to his children. And God wants us to be filled with joy, with his joy. Do you see that movement? You got to see that movement. God is joy. God delights to save his children. And God wants you to be filled with joy. See, now you're ready to understand this truth, that where the Spirit of the Lord is, the fruit that is produced is joy. Joy is not an option. It's a fundamental characteristic of the Christian life. You cannot think of fish without water. You cannot think of the sun without light. You cannot be around a new grandparent without looking at pictures and hearing about first words and first steps. And you cannot describe a person who has come to faith in Jesus Christ, is filled with the Holy Spirit, and not use the word joy. To be a joyless Christian is a contradiction in terms. So is joy evident in your life? Because God delights to produce it in you. Remember from last week, the fruit of the Spirit is not a personality trait. There is one fruit. All are included. All are evident. You cannot say, I have self-discipline and self-control, but not joy. You can't. Because if the Spirit of God is there, it's all there. To be filled with the Spirit is to have joy. Not only that, we are called to grow in joy, right? The longer that you've been in the Spirit, you should be growing in joy. Meeting our oldest saints should not be known as grumpy old folks, but the most joyful in the bunch. I know your body's aging and that aches and pains, they demand to be heard, but the Spirit of God is greater. And as with all the fruit of the Spirit, these are virtues that are commanded so that we are both dependent and responsible. Dependent in the fact that it's God's joy, God's the one that produces it in me, but responsible in that we are commanded to rejoice always. Again, I say rejoice. That is in the midst of trials and difficulties. Again, I say rejoice. Abide, lead your heart, cling to the vine. He will produce it. So let me pause here and define for us joy. Joy is a deep sense of happiness and well-being in our soul, produced by the Holy Spirit, that is not determined by our circumstances, but rather is the overflow, being able to go through life and in all circumstances, be able to see the beauty of Jesus. That's what joy is. And guys, this sermon is not meant to be heavy-handed. You may be sitting there saying, I don't measure up. My joy is fleeting. I worry. I'm in a difficult season of life. So let's pause and let's ask, what commonly steals our joy and how do we fight to get it back? So number one, sin steals our joy because it breaks fellowship with God. You cannot walk in darkness and have fellowship with God. You understand that, right? You know it intrinsically in your soul. You can lie to yourself for a period of time. You cannot walk in darkness and have fellowship with God. It separates you. Listen to David, how he spoke after hiding, after he sinned with Bathsheba. Psalm 32, he says, when I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as with the fever heat of the summer. You see, because of his sin, his joy was gone. Now, let's not be foolish, because David wasn't this downcast and troubled while he was sinning. But that's how sin works. It's a counterfeit to joy, a shortcut to joy. Oh, God says joy comes through waiting for him. Well, that takes too long. I want instant happiness. Find your joy in stuff, drunkenness, endless entertainment, gluttony. But you see, it never lasts. The joys of the world are always fleeting. The party always comes to an end, and it leaves you sitting there longing, just like David, longing for the pure joy, the joy-filled presence of God. So what do? Confess your sins. Come back and kneel at the foot of the cross. Believer, God is not mad at you. You need to hear me say that. God is not mad at you. Do you understand? His son has paid the full measure of your sin. And the Father is fixed with that attitude. He's not mad at you. He longs for his child to come home. Do you sit here this morning with some unconfessed sin that you need to lay at the foot of the altar? Can I just give testimony? Last week, that's where I was. And I came down here at the front at the end, and it was a sin that I had held on to far too long. Can I just tell you, there was joy on the other side? There's joy on the other side. The second thing that steals our joy, often our previous hurts. Some of you have wounds from the past that bubble up and you cannot get over. Anger, anxiety, hopelessness, despair. And those wounds continue to steal your joy. I know that you've tried to move on. You've boarded up that door. You've hung up a sign that says, stay out, because you know inside that room is only darkness. Friend, Psalm 34 says, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. The Bible says that Jesus is gentle, patient, and kind, and that he will meet you in your hurt and wants to replace it with joy. In my old church, one of the senior saints that was filled with joy, in her 80s, filled with joy all the time. Like, you look forward to those senior saints and you say, how did you age so well? How are you so filled with joy? Catch this. One day I sat down with her, heard her testimony. I was shocked to find when she was a young teenager, her father had committed suicide in front of her. Just a short time later, her mother died. When she showed up at her aunt and uncle's house, she was told, no one in the family wants you. And as I sat there, I said, how? Could that be your story? How are you filled with this much joy?
Jesus.
Amen. Listen, I'm not saying it was easy. She would be the first to tell you there were some painful nights, lots of stuff to go through. But in the end, Jesus wants to meet you in your hurt and replace it with joy. Number three, difficult circumstances or trials steal our joy. We live in a broken world with broken bodies. We get tired, busy, and quickly to the end of our rope, right? I am out of energy and resources. I'm done. Our bones crack, and when pain shouts, it demands to be heard. Relationships are difficult, all the way from marriage to children to in-laws to friends to bosses, coworkers. And the refrain is, those people stole my joy. Why are you letting them steal your joy? Because they cannot steal the joy of the Holy Spirit. The one that the Holy Spirit gives you, they cannot touch unless you let them. And when difficult circumstances hit, our joy gets replaced, catch this, with self-pity. So how do you get your joy back? You remember the promises of God. The promises of God are greater than your circumstances. Did God not say that he was your ever-present help in time of trouble? Did he not say that he would cause all things to work together for your good? Did he not say, rejoice when you are persecuted for being righteous, because there is an eternal reward for you? This world is not your home, but look forward to what is coming. And then we will be able to respond with Habakkuk. Though the fig tree should not blossom and there be no fruit on the vines, yet I will exult in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. And fourthly, what steals our joy is fear about the future. Fear about the future. Fear is the ultimate killjoy. It's the opposite emotion from joy, is fear. And the uncertainty about the future is ripe breeding ground for fear. What's going to happen with my job? My kids, my grandkids? What career path should I take? What if I miss my calling in life? What if I miss everything that God has for me? What if I don't have enough money to retire? Stock market and inflation. Look at the direction that this nation is going in. So many things are outside of our control. We find that our arms are too short. Listen, Lane and I literally go to war with our kids every night just to get them in bed. I could not stand here and predict within 30 minutes the time that all three of my kids are going to be asleep tonight. How am I supposed to know anything about the future? I don't. But I know who does. But I know who does. Listen to me. Joy is tied to hope for the future. As an A&M football fan who just landed the number one recruiting class, I am very hope-filled and joy about the future of Aggie football. Can I get a whoop? There we go. Believer, Christ has given you every reason to hope for the future. He is inside of you and gives you joy. He promises to never leave you and to equip you through the trials of life, that he is an ever-present help. And listen, he has also promised that you cannot even comprehend how good heaven is and what awaits you. You have every reason to be filled with his joy. And say with Nehemiah, for the joy of the Lord is my strength. I want you to watch this quick video.
You know, my son is getting older and we're
approaching the time where we're going to have the talk.
I mean, there's a real battle going on out there for the hearts and minds of our children.
We decided to be more proactive and intentional with our daughter.
My father instilled in me this passion, and his father before him.
It's important to start young when building a foundation. So when the hard times hit, they won't stray. They will remain faithful.
It's never too early to introduce your kids to your favorite sports team.
We live in Dallas, so a lot of the kids on the playground are Cowboy fans. We're going to try to keep her Cowboy free as long as possible.
I had her yelling Lakers when she was still in the womb.
There are a few very important things that he needs to know before growing up. One, that Michael Jordan is the best to ever play the game, hands down. I don't want my son to grow up in a world where LeBron James is the greatest of all time. I mean, 6 championships, end of discussion.
The Cowboys cheat, the Cowboys killed SpongeBob, whatever it takes to get this idea out of her head that the Cowboys are cool, I will do it.
I have a daughter, but hey, who said it was gonna be easy? It's all about being intentional. All you have to do is plant the seed.
As a Red Sox fan, I really want to teach him.
Hey, Dad, Mom needs you downstairs.
You know, I didn't start early enough with that one. I wish I had.
Could I accept my son liking another team besides mine? No, I couldn't. Does that make me a bad father? No, it makes me a great father.
Now, you guys ruined my boys, just so you know, all 3 of my kids, because 2 weeks into being here, the choir sang the national anthem at the Spurs game, and we tagged along. And so their first experience at a professional sport venue was getting to go on the court and sit there while our choir sang and be behind the stadium and got to meet David Robinson. All right, so my kids are in Spurs gear, and I hate it because I'm a Mavs fan for life, but you guys have ruined them. I did not start early enough. I am working on converting them. Hey, listen, I show a funny video about the passion of passing down your favorite sports team. Now, let me get serious with you because I mean this with all my heart. Church and family member, if we are to pass down our faith, it must be through joy and passion and delight. That the joy of the Lord is your strength. Grandparent, parent, if you expect your children to latch on to something, to Jesus with faith, listen to me. It's got to be joy passed down. And what an opportunity for us as a church in a culture that is desperate for some real weighty joy. Everything they run to is so fleeting, guys. It's so fleeting. It's initial passions that they run to for temporary fulfillment, and it's a vapor. It escapes them. It never makes you happy. What an opportunity for us to shine the light of Jesus that says, come, I have found the lover of my soul, the one who gives joy, unending, a weight to it that is greater than my circumstances, so that my circumstances may go like this, but I am anchored on the rock, on the one who is constant, the one who never changes, and the one who gives me joy. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, this morning, I know all across this room, we have needed to pause and to meditate on your goodness, that you are joy, and that to know you is to experience joy. And to meditate on with joy it is that you sent your son. That with delight you saved us. And that your fixed countenance towards us is not anger, but rather in Christ, you are filled with joy. Father, help us to drink that in, because we are feeble and we have leaky buckets. And in and of ourselves, Father, all of our joy is fleeting. We are dependent upon you. And so this morning, we cling to you. We abide in you. We lead our hearts to the fountain of joy. We say, God, would you restore to us the joy of our salvation? Would you restore to us the joy of our salvation? Would you forgive us when we're cranky and tired and short-fused? We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.